As you start to run OpenTelemetry at scale, you're going to have lots of microservices, containers, hosts, all this kind of stuff producing telemetry. And of course, you'll be spinning up more than one or more than a few OpenTelemetry collector instances, I bet. Which leads to the obvious question, how do you actually manage all of that at scale? You've got multiple collectors out there, you've got multiple telemetry producing entities. How do you know which versions of things you've got running, where they're running, are they still connected, how much work each collector is processing, etc., etc.? And that's where the OpAMP protocol, OpAMP protocol, comes in. Now, it's important to hear that when I'm talking about an agent, what I really mean is any agent on the end machine or a collector. So in other words, an OpenTelemetry collector, you can think of it for the purposes of this video as an agent. So OpAMP is the Open Agent Management Protocol. It's a network protocol which describes how large fleets of remote data collection agents like OpenTelemetry collectors are visualized, are managed, are downgraded, upgraded, restarted, and all of that kind of thing. So it really gives you that ability to do things at scale. Now, the cool thing here is because OpAMP is vendor neutral, any software could also adopt the OpAMP protocol. So think of security agents, observability agents, and then you're going to have one place and one way to manage all of those end agents. So the OpAMP protocol defines how an agent and server speak to each other and allows the agents to be remotely configured from the server, so you can securely up or downgrade agents from a central point, a central server. Agents can report their status, such as their health or version information, back to the server. So again, you can see all of your collector versions and the components. They can report their own telemetry, of course, as you'd expect, like CPU and RAM, how much they're utilizing, and obviously, as I say, how much data they're processing back to a separate observability backend. Agents can also send heartbeat pings to the server just to prove that they're still online and still available. The server can also be used for credential management of the agent to server connection, so you can revoke and rotate TLS certificates. So how does it all work? Let's start looking at the server. This is obviously the central component where agents, in our case for this video, it's OpenTelemetry collectors, connect. So think of the client-server model. Your collectors are the client talking to a server. So connections can be either via WebSocket gRPC or HTTP. Now, optionally, the agent could also start a watchdog process first, which is then responsible for managing the lifecycle of the collector. It's actually called the OpAMP supervisor process. So the supervisor would then start the collector process. In either case, whether you're just running with the OpAMP client or the supervisor, the agent is configured to know where the server lives, and so the communication begins. Now, all communications to and from the components are via binary encoded protobuf. So first, let's look at the way the agent can communicate things to the server, and it does so via an agent to server message. And here's what the agent can say to the server. So first up is an agent UUID. This is a UUID from the agent for this agent in the V7 format. The next field is sequence num, and it's simply a counter which increments for every message that the agent sends to the server. So then you can use it to detect whether you've actually missed or the server has missed a message from this agent. And then, of course, you can take the right appropriate action to remedy that fix. The agent description field is a field which includes information about the agent, of course. The capabilities field is how the agent signals to the server what the agent can actually do. The health field is a place for the agent to signal its current overall health and the subcomponents or pieces of the agent and their individual health. Effective config is a place that the agent reports the currently active configuration. In this case, you know, in an OpenTelemetry collector, it would be the YAML configuration that the agent is currently running. So if effective config is the currently effective configuration that's running, what's remote config? If the server has previously sent any configuration to the agent, then this field shows the status of that configuration. The package statuses field. Now think of packages as the functionality offered by an agent. Now, each agent, and remember, an agent in this case could be kind of attached to a collector, has a primary package. So a collector, that's the agent's core functionality, and zero or more sub packages. So think of these as plugins. The flags field is used to request things of or from the server. Currently, the only flag, as I record, that's implemented is the request instance UUID, which instructs the server to generate a new UUID for this agent. The server will then return the new UUID via a server to agent message, more about that in a moment, and the agent can then update its UUID agent. Connection settings request field is a field whereby the agent is requesting that the server create and respond back to the agent, offering a set of suggested connection settings. So think about if the agent somehow detects that the connection is a bit flaky, it can request new connections from the server. Custom capabilities as an optional set of fully qualified domain name capabilities with optional version information. Now that's a mouthful, but what it basically means is the agent could have a custom capability in the agent server message of, for example, com.mycompany.foo/v2. And that states, when that's in that message, it states that the agent supports the foo capability at version 2 from mycompany.com. Now, importantly, the agent might also support com.anothercompany.foo/v2, and the fully qualified domain name, the reverse FQDN, prevents any collision for that foo capability. Custom message is simply a place for the agent to put a custom message back to the server, so that can be anything you like. So that's what the agent can say and send and do to the server and request of the server. What about the other way around? What can the server say to, send to, ask of the agent? Now, as you may have guessed, these are defined in server to agent messages. So these are the messages that go the other way. We've got an instance UID again, but this time it's defined the agent to which this server wants to send a message. Remember, the server is talking to multiple agents, so we need a way to direct the message to the right agent. The error response field will be set if the agent wants to indicate that an error has occurred while processing a previous instruction or a previous agent to server message. Now, in a server to agent message, when the remote config field is set, the server is offering the agent a piece of remote configuration, and then obviously it's up to the agent to either use that or not. When the connection settings field is set, the server is indicating that it wishes the agent to change its connection settings, and it's actually providing a suggested a new set of connections. Packages available. As the name suggests, when this is set, the server is informing the agent that new packages or sub-packages are available for the agent from the server for the agent to use. The flags field. As in the agent to server messages, flags are used to request things to or from the agent this time. So currently one flag is implemented, and it's the report full state, whereby the server is requesting that the agent send a dump of its entire current state, i.e. a new full agent server message with nothing missing, and not just a heartbeat request. So the server can say, something went wrong, I just need you to send me absolutely everything about you so that I can update my records, and this server can request that. Now it's up to the agent to actually honor that and send that back. The capabilities field is much like the agent to server message. It's what can this server do? What things can this server do or support? For example, can the server accept status reports? Does it offer packages to agent? Does it accept requests from the agent to generate new connection settings and also send new offers back to the agent? So what does the server actually support? So the server can self-identify what's available. Now, the agent identification fields are fields related to the ID of the agent the server wishes to communicate with. Currently, the only implemented field is new instance ID, which is only set in response to an agent to server message where the agent is actually requesting that the server generate a new field. And so that's where the new UID gets sent back. Custom capabilities and custom messages are exactly as described for the agent to server, but obviously the other way around. Now, that's probably a much deeper dive into the OpAMP spec that you wanted or thought you were going to get at this stage, but I hope it sets the stage for what you're about to see. So let's jump into the demo and let's have a look at an OpAMP server. So I'm not going to go through this at length, of course, but I'll just give you a brief overview. The first endpoint for this server is v1/opamp, and that is the standard endpoint that agents will look for and try and connect to. So basically what we're doing here is we're receiving the request and we're just passing all of the data into and doing something with it. And I'll show you that in a moment. I'm not going to dig too deeply into what we're doing at the moment. You'll see that. Then we have a set of endpoints that we humans use. We've got the root path, which gives us a nice UI. We've got a path called /agents, which, as you probably expect, is just a list of all of the agents, i.e. OpenTelemetry collectors or other software that are currently connected to the server. And then we can drill into each agent with the agent slash, and then we provide a UID to get deeper level details of the agents. So let's start up the server. There we have it, a very simple page, no agents connected, but the server is running. So let's now start an OpenTelemetry collector to connect to the server via OpAMP. And there we go, the collector has started, and let's refresh this page, and we see one agent connected. Now, just before I go on, I'm going to show you the collector. So I'm running the contrib collector because it has the OpAMP extension. So here I'm saying OpAMP extension, I want to speak to a server, I want to do it on HTTP rather than WebSockets, and I want pointing it to an endpoint, localhost 4320 v1 opamp. That should make sense now. We're trying to talk to our server that's running, and the collector is going to try and talk to the server every 5 seconds. Now, this is an optional field, instance UID. Honestly, I've had it in here for testing just to keep things keep this UID constant, because if you don't have this, if you comment this out, as soon as the agent talks to the server will generate a unique ID for that agent. And then we get into the agent description and some non-identifying attributes. And here I've given my agent a nice description. And also, just so you see, some key value pairs, this can be whatever you like. Then I set up the capabilities. So what can this agent actually do? Then bog standard OpenTelemetry stuff. We have some receivers, in this case one, we've got a file log receiver, we've got an exporter to debug, and we've got a single pipeline. It's a logs pipeline called blah, and it has a single receiver, a file log receiver, no processors, and an exporter. So as basic as you can get with OpAMP extensions, just to show what we can do, and then we add the extension here. So now that we've got the collector started, we can see it connecting to the server. Let's drill into the agent. So we see our agent ID. We see that the agent itself is healthy, and we see that it has some tags, like service name is the name of the binary, the version of the collector that's currently running 0.121.0. Here are my description tags and my foobar. You know, you saw that in the YAML file, but it's also pulling the host architecture, the host name, the operating system description, and the type. So this is your high level overview of all of your collectors, all of your agents that are talking to this server. Let's drill a little bit deeper and see what we can get. If I have a look at an agent, we get some of the same information, the agent ID, its overall health status, the start time and the time that it last sent an update to the server. We get the tags again, but this time we get a lot deeper level information. So reporting, the agent capabilities, what, because imagine if you don't see that YAML file, you'd be left thinking, well, what can the agent do? And these are the things that the agent reports to the server. It reports its status, it reports its effective config, and it reports its health. These are the things the agent accepts from the server, which currently nothing. So even if the server tried to send some new configuration or packages, or even ask the agent to restart, because obviously if you're doing an update, you might need this collector to restart, and the collector's just going to ignore that command completely. Scrolling further down, we have our pipelines. So we've got a single pipeline, as you saw in the YAML, but remember, imagine we don't have access to that YAML. It's a logs pipeline called blah, and actually the pipeline itself is healthy, and here we see the status of each of the components. The green box are the receivers. So we've got our file log receiver, it's healthy, status is okay, and its last status, we see the time that we last saw the file log receiver inside this collector. No processors, and the debug exporter, again, that is healthy. So this is a really easy way to see what is going on, what has someone actually configured in my collector. And then if you really want to see the YAML, if the agent reports its current config, then you see the actual YAML file in here. Then we come down to the agent components. Now, remember, I said I was running the contrib collector. If you know the contrib collector, you'll know there's a lot more components in there that I'm using. It's not just the file log and the debug. And this list gives you a full list of what's going on. So we've got a full list of receivers that are bundled in with this collector. So if someone in your company said, oh, we're running that collector, what's it got in it? What can it do? And what versions? Are we vulnerable? Because we've heard, you know, some version 120 of the React receiver is vulnerable. For example, it's not, but just as an example, you can say, oh, don't worry, we're running 121, or it's not even in here. So there you are. That's quite a deep dive into the OpAMP protocol, and also showing you the Python server that I'm building. So if you know Python, please do come and help me build it. The more the merrier on that. It's completely open. And yeah, try it out. See what you want. Raise requests, etc., etc. I think OpAMP will be the future of how we upgrade, manage agents at sort of business and enterprise scale, because it's a vendor-neutral protocol, so security tools could use this, logging tools could use this, obviously observability tools, so anything that's sitting on a server, reporting back to a server that needs updates or needs upgrades or maintenance, I think could leverage this protocol. That's exactly what it's for. And I'm looking forward to a day where you just say, oh yeah, just connect it to the server, and all of a sudden you've got a single pane of glass for all of your agents, for all of your fleet management. So I hope you found this useful, and I'll see you again soon for more OpenTelemetry, DevOps and Observability content. Until then.